Hello students. So in our D.El.Ed, we are these days discussing constructivist approach based learning methods and activities. Now learning methods we have discussed in previous three lessons, and today my focus would be on activity based approaches of learning which become learning friendly. So activity based classroom activities where students get lot of opportunities to be actively participating and experiential learning. So learner is not a passive listener. Learner is not receiving a lecture or getting a question to be answered, but there is a situation and activity is being organized and student is joyfully participating in the activity and experiential learning, or I can say participatory learning is taking place. So that is the crux of today's lesson which we are discussing today, activity based approach as learner and learning friendly approach. Activity based approach, what is the objective? First, activity is an objective oriented task in which learner gets spontaneously involved and derives pleasure in achieving the learning objectives. So learning objectives are set. It is not an activity being organized without any planning and without any objectives. Objectives are very clear, well known to teacher and learner. In the light of those objectives, now we are planning an activity. So what activity is guided by? It is guided by the objectives which are deriving from the agenda for the day or text for the day or chapter for the day. Here learner is deriving pleasure in achieving the learning objectives because learner is not receiving but performing, and in this performance he or she is deriving a pleasure because activity is leading to the objectives of learning. In the activity based approach, importance is given to the learner who gets new knowledge by doing activity in his own environment. So the activity based approach is both learner as well as learning friendly. I can say teacher is not getting a dominating space here because it is not teacher dominating or teaching teacher based approach. It is a activity based approach where learning and learner both are enjoying. We can organize an activity in the form of a game, story, role play or song. These are however not only these ways, but activities can also be performed in several other ways. Activity can provide scope for each child to participate. Now how each child can participate? Not necessarily by actively performing in the activity, maybe by behind the screen he or she is working behind the screen, like writing text, helping preparation of costumes, designing the situation, pushing and presenting and removing the furniture required, and such other supports which generally is required in any activity. So every child, rather I should say each child, each student is important and participating in the activity. So what I want to say here is that we should plan an activity where there is a scope to involve larger group or larger, or I should say maximum. If we involve maximum in writing, in designing, in planning, in preparing, in doing the groundwork, in support staff, whatever mode we can accommodate them, whatever mode we can involve students, we should try to involve. That is the spirit of an activity approach. Every activity may or may not need physical exercise, but needs mental exercise, like thinking, discriminating, arranging in serial, developing problem, solving problem, skills, etc., etc., etc. Now, involvement and participation in each activity gives a sense of satisfaction to a student. Today, the activity being done the person who is narrating from behind is me. So that gives a pleasure and ownership. So student feel honored and activity is belonging to the learners group. And that is the strength of this activity-based approach. My making small changes. One activity may be used for achieving other objectives. So if one activity need to be repeated with a different objective and with minor changes we can manage it, we should try to manage it. Because for this revised activity, adapted situation, we need to put in a lesser effort. Now, what is an activity and what are the elements of an activity? There are four major elements of an effective learning activity. One is focused, other is challenge, next is spontaneity, and fourth is it should be joyful. First, focused. Activity for learning is always goal-oriented and is so designed that the participating students are focused to solve the problem or to reach the target and are not easily distracted. So they are focused, they know what they are doing, their objective is clear, they are going along with the situation, and that is the important aspect of any activity. Second, it should be challenging. Students should not be just participating in an activity just for the sake of participating in an activity. The activity should pose a challenge before them. They should feel inspired, motivated. Let's do it. I can try it out. An effective activity poses a challenge before the class. It is neither too easy to neglect nor too difficult to attempt. So, challenge doesn't mean difficulty always. It should be difficult but not beyond attempt, beyond solution. It should be within the solution. Students should feel inspired. Let us try it out and let's solve it. So, if students find it that it is neither too easy to be neglected, I'm not interested. It's very easy. What kiddish? Or it should not be very difficult, where a lot of intellectual processes are required. It should be welcoming to come and try it out. It is moderately difficult, which is within the capacity of the students to solve, but with concentration and with little more effort. So that is also important. Spontaneous involvement. A good activity is such that it attracts the students immediately. When it starts and they join in, it should be arousing, inviting their interest, developing their interest without any persuasion or compulsion. So when a activity is paused before the class, let students volunteer themselves, let them involve themselves on their own instead of always trying to pursue them, okay, we'll do this, who will participate? No, this is not required. In an activity, let learner be actively participating it out of their own urge to participation. And it should be joyful. The test of the efficacy of the activity is when the student drives a sense of satisfaction after its completion. The very nature of a good activity is that it is interesting for the students to conduct and it brings a sense of achievement, provides joy, which ultimately becomes a source of intrinsic motivation for the students to go for that next activity, which might be a little more challenging, little more difficult. Now, what are the characteristics of activity-based approaches of teaching and learning? First, nature of presentation of activities differ in different activities being taken up. It is not that every activity will start with a mental exercise, let's think over it first. No, not all the activities. In some activities, we inductive mode or deductive mode. We can pause a difficult situation and then try to gradually resolve it, to simplify it, to relate it with the content. Or we can start it with day-to-day life experiences and gradually take them to a difficult orders where they find it to reaching to a theory, to reaching to a concept in theoretical framework. So all the activities we are planning for a class should not be uniform in nature in any way. They should be different, their mode should be different, their participation level should be different. In some activities, we need a little warm up. In some other activities, we need to be relaxed. If activities related to a political agitation, political parties' involvement, political debates, then we need to motivate them to be actively participating. So, a little warm up activity by posing small questions, we can see that my learner is intellectually active and physically charged to participate. And in another situation where we are trying to help them be tolerant, be patient, be collaborative, there we need to help them understand. So, it is not important to speak all the time. Sometimes it's equally important to listen, to give space to others. So, all activities demand different start and different finish. Participation of all the students is essential, should be encouraged. Activities provide enough scope for learning in one's own style, one's own pace. It develops the ability of self-learning. While performing activities, one develops the ability to inquiry, assessing one's own knowledge and constructing new knowledge at the same time. Community involvement in activity. Several community resources can be utilized to make an activity more meaningful and more contextual. For example, we are helping the class to understand the role of police in maintaining law and order. So, instead of involving students only, community involvement, like inviting a police constable, police inspector to a classroom situation, or somebody who had some direct relation with working of the police, can be called to enrich the activity. And this way, learners will not only assess their own knowledge, but also construct new knowledge in the situation. Community involvement does help us to make it more meaningful and more contextual. Learning to know, learning to do, learning to live. Learning to be the four pillars of learning is possible through activity-based approach. So, activity-based approach in a way suggests us to know, to do, to live together and to be. So, all these become crucial in a activity-based learning. Process of assessment here is that an activity approach of learning, the process of assessment of learning, specifically during the formative stage, involves self-assessment, encourage peer assessment and or group assessment, which need to be carried out on continuous basis so that students get to know about their progress in the learning and are able to improve their learning based on the feedback they get from time to time. In activity-based learning situation, time management. In activity-based learning situation, time management is another important aspect. Generally, activities demand longer time, maybe beyond one class period. But that doesn't mean we should refrain ourselves from organizing an activity. But we should learn to organize, to optimize the time so as to make it more interesting and within the time frame. So, activity-based approaches require proper time management, which all teachers should keep in mind. Methods being used in activity approach is, in an activity-based approach, importance is given to the learner who gets new knowledge by doing activity in his or her own environment. While participating in an activity, either in group or individual or peer, learning situations, a student is required to perform different tasks using multiple methods, which require several abilities at the same time. In an activity, it doesn't happen that one time action is happening, another time thinking is happening, another time resources being arranged. No. Thinking, reasoning, searching for the alternatives, responding to a socially desirable way, emotional control. I should not got unnecessarily agitated. I should not be emotionally breakdown in the activity situation. So activity help us performing multiple roles at a time. We are thinking, we are rationalizing, we are finding alternatives, we are conducting ourselves in socially desirable way, we try to compose ourselves emotionally controlled, cooperation, etc. Therefore, performing activities as a regular teacher, as a regular classroom practitioner, we should try to have several cognitive, socio-emotional, psychomotor aspects of learners and ensuring the development of the holistic personality of the learner rather than just suggesting them activities and going ahead. Now, I'll be suggesting you a list of some methods being employed under activity-based approach. First is question answer. Few of you can think, is it an activity? Yes, it is an activity. In question answer activity, questions are prepared, planned, and the nature of question should be exploratory. Students should feel motivated to find out the answer. It should not be readily available. It should be contextual. It should be leading. We pose question to lead the class to the content. So, what type of questions I am going to ask is important. When towards the end of the session, when we want our class to question, when we want our students to question, that time these principles doesn't work. We do not expect our students to pose sensible question always. Maybe their question is very basic. But since they are posing a question, means they have a query. So here the principle which is governing is learner's query that should be satisfied, that should be helped. On the teacher's part, it should be well designed, well planned, well articulated, and leading to the text and the content. So it should be gradually, maybe from difficulty level is raising from each question and taking it to a little difficult cognitive level, cognitive situations. So question answer become an activity through a quiz or through a question answer method. Second method which is employed under activity based approach is case study. Now case study is a psychological term generally used for clinical psychology, but that doesn't mean case study is only psychological. It can happen in a classroom situation where we want our learners to study Delhi as a metropolitan city, to study Ambala as a regional hub of Haryana and Punjab. So finding a case, its history, its geography, its culture, its linguistic competencies, language development, history of language, its market, its trends, its social status of the people there, their language, academic institutions available in that region, that city. So all these collectively become case study of a city, be it Ambala, be it Delhi, be it any other important city or place or region in India or abroad, anywhere. Case studies can be conducted over individuals as well, over situations as well. So case study doesn't confine to a city. It can be to individual, to a political party, to a economic business house. Anything can be taken up as a case study where we motivate students to actively probe into the context, probe into the case. As I stated earlier, the case can be a city, a group of people, a political party, a business house, anything can be taken up as a case. And exploring it, probing it holistically, comprehensively, makes it a case study. Next activity which can be taken up is community resource. Community resource, like I stated in during my discussion, as resource which belongs to community, like a historical monument, Parliament House, Vidhan Sabha House of the state concern, village panchayat, post office, police station, employment exchange office, all these institutions are community resources meant for community. But we can always make academic use of these community resources. We can take our class to this situation, to a historical monument. That historical monument was not made for my class, that one day my class will come here and learn the architecture of Mughals or architecture of Qutubs or architecture of 16th century. No, these were meant for some different purpose. But because architecture students can always go there and understand the architecture, through architecture we can try to understand the culture, the living style, the ornaments of the people they were wearing through sculptures made there, through the paintings made there. Similarly, if we are taking our students to a police station, the police station is not meant as an educative instrument, as an educative institution. It is made to maintain law and order. But I want my students to understand the role of police in maintaining law and order. So I can take my students and help them understand what are the different types of cases, what are the civil cases and what are the other type of cases, how policeman decides the nature of case, and how, what level of policeman is supposed to be involved in a type of case. If it is a robbery case, if it's a murder case, if it's a rape case, or if it's a snatching case. So what is the role of constable there? What is the role of other supporting agencies, forensic science, forensic department within police, detective agencies, detective media's role? All these things can be helped understood, better understood in a situation like a police station where we took our students to understand, or a hospital for that reason. I take my students to a community resource, a hospital, and help them understand how hospital works, how it is useful, why government invest lot of money on maintaining of hospitals, constructing, developing new hospitals, bringing new equipments to a hospital, and how it is helping the state to become a welfare state. So community resource can also be taken up as an activity. Comparative approach. In comparative approach, we compare two components of some common basis. Comparison always help us understand how my system, my situation, my working, my condition is better or worse than the other people's context, other countries' context. For example, if I help my learner to understand presidential form of government on one hand and prime ministerial form of government on another hand, so I can easily make a comparison between Prime Minister of India or Prime Minister of England with President of France or President of America. Now these two executive head in two types of system, one is parliamentary, other is presidential. How they are working? Help my learner understand which democracy is better, where we are practicing direct democracy, where people are electing the president directly, the whole nation is actively voting in the selection of executive head for the nation, and on the other hand, the parliamentary model, where people are electing their representatives, and those representatives collectively, the majority party will elect its leader as the executive head for the nation. So comparative method is also helpful. Current event, it's very commonly used in social sciences as well as in literature. Current events which are happening around, if I have to teach presidential election and president election is by chance happening next month, I can ask my students to keep a close eye on the president's election And along with the practical aspect which they are observing in television, in radio, in newspaper, in daily discussions in the families and neighborhood, they can relate it with the theoretical aspect which is given in the textbook. General elections, municipality election, assembly election or parliamentary election. How political parties are deciding their candidates? What are the factors helping them decide this candidate is good for this community because this constituency has more of Muslim population, this constituency has more of Hindi speaking people, this constituency have more of women voters, this constituency has more of literate population. So all these factors are influencing parliamentary political parties' decision to elect their parties parliamentarians. So these current events always help the class to relate the day-to-day happening with the text being taught or being preserved in the classroom situation. Dialogue is a method where not as a teacher I am narrating, I am lecturing, but dialogue between two of us. I am pausing some situation, some example, you are countering it, supporting it, challenging it, explaining it, enriching it with your experiences and understanding. So dialogue is two ways, always helpful. Discussion, for that reason. Whenever we are conducting something which is very common, which is very general to the people of my students' age, I can enrich a discussion. Any theme, science is curse or a boon, let's discuss it. Bane or a boon, let's discuss it in the classroom situation. So there may be people in the class who would say it's a bane and there may be people who would say it's a boon. Let them give their examples. Let them satisfy each other's queries. Let them defend their stand. And this will help them developing a rich discussion on the nature of science and its use in our daily life. Dramatization. Always attract young children. If I see something, I participate in something, I do some acting with some different costume, my dialogues changing voice, modulation is changing, facial expressions are changing. So I am dramatizing something and I am participating in one character which is coming again to my heart and soul. Excursion, educational excursion, taking a class to a different situation. My city children, my city students do not know much about village life. And in village life is not uniform. It is different. Village life is different in urban village, rural village, village on hills, village in disturbance areas, maybe Naxalite areas, insurgency areas. So villages are having different types of life among villages itself. So I organize an excursion to a village and want my learners to understand challenges of village life. They'll closely observe it, have their first-hand experience talking to the villagers, seeing what is the position of women there. In textbook, we read that this woman is given lesser space and woman is given lesser voices. But in actual village life situation, it can be different. Situations can appear different. Maybe they are completely silent. Maybe they are very vocal, very confident. Maybe there are no opportunities of education. So most of the people are illiterate, less educated, less literate. So such activities, such experiences are enriched with real situations, which are educational excursions give us opportunity to take our class to a real life situation and help them understand the situation in itself. Field research, visit to the institutions, government bodies, individual or group projects, and panel discussions. Panel discussions means we identify a theme, and within that theme, there are two or three prominent sub-themes. So we invite people from that theme and supplementary supporting sub-themes. So each panelist will highlight one important aspect of that theme, and gradually all three speakers will help the class, help the audiences to understand the theme in comprehensive mode, because one speaker is speaking on one important aspect, another speaker is speaking on another important aspect. There may be three speakers, there may be four speakers. And towards the end, the chair of the panel is concluding by adding his or her own comments and by summarizing opinion of different panelists. This way, with this activity, we can easily resolve a complicated theme into a simplified fashion with different experts. So today's lesson, we have tried to understand what are the activities means, how different activities help learning, how activity-based approaches are more meaningful, where student is actively participating in the learning process, in the learning context, what are the different activities, be it dramatics, be it classroom community resources, be it debate, comparison, and few more. So activity orientation, activity-based approaches directly involve students, where students not only actively participate, but also visualize, contextualize, enrich, document, so many ways. And it gives space to each and every learner of my class to be actively participating in the activity. So today's lesson was about activity-based approach. I hope you will try it out during your internship. All the best. Bye-bye.